Joy Grace and Coral Hines saved countless lives in World War II, but for decades they didn't breathe a word of it.
It was ultra top secret what we were doing. It mightn't have seemed to be very much, but it was so important.
We had to be of reputable character and we had to be trusted.
In 1943, as the war in the Pacific raged on, a growing number of women were recruited to Australia's armed services. Coral was only 18 when she joined the army.
We used to help make camouflage nets and we sort of got into the war thing. And then when I was able to join up, I didn't have any bother.
Joy wasn't quite as enthusiastic. Then, 20 years old, she was happily working as a cashier in Sydney when she received a letter from the government.
It said that I was working in a non-essential industry. I could work in a factory or join one of the women's services. I decided I'd join the army.
Coral and Joy trained as wireless operators and were hand-picked for Central Bureau, a joint US-Australian signals intelligence organisation, and the Australian outpost of the famous Bletchley Park, which cracked the Nazi Enigma code.
That machine can be set up in 186 million, million, million ways.
Author Ali Sinclair has based her latest novel on Australia's female codebreakers.
Central Bureau deliberately had a very boring name, so people didn't really suspect anything. Even the neighbours had no idea what was going on in their own street.
Coral and Joy decoded incoming Japanese Morse signals and encoded Australian war secrets to be sent overseas. It was highly classified work.
The women had a special key, and this key was a special code that they used for each message, and they unscrambled the messages that way.
We really didn't have much time to think about it other than get those messages and get rid of them, get them where they're going to.
The codebreakers carried out their important work in a small garage out the back of a Brisbane mansion.
That's how I became a garage girl. We weren't allowed to tell what we were doing anyway, but yes, we were just one of the garage girls.
We lived together, ate together, spent our spare time together. We got on well with my little group.
It wasn't just the women who bonded on the job. In the garage, Coral met a young airman named Sandy.
We got talking and he asked me to go out with him. Eventually he said to me that they'd had word to say that tomorrow they're going north.
Sandy was sent to Papua New Guinea. Despite the distance, the young couple kept in touch, adding secret love notes to the wireless messages being sent to and from the region.
You know, Sandy sends love to Coral. We cheated the powers that be.
There was a time there where she wasn't well and she was put in the hospital. And I put a little note on the monitor, Coral's in hospital. And, you know, we're told not to do it, but silly did it. Anyhow, he tore off the message and he carried around with it in his pocket for the rest of their married life, I think.
In 1944, Coral received a letter from Sandy in the Philippines.
One of his mates came down on leave and brought a letter and he proposed to me. And, of course, I can see myself now tearing out to the office and telling everybody.
The pair married and spent more than 60 years together until Sandy passed away in 2007.
We just fell in love, I suppose. He was so gentle. It was just wonderful.
The garage girls were credited with tracking down a Japanese general and helping to shorten the war by 2 years. But even after the war ended, they had to keep their work a secret.
What they worked on for Central Bureau was really significant still to Australia's security, which may, you know, have been one of the reasons that the Official Secrets Act that they signed was extended for such a long time.
It was more than 60 years before their service was publicly recognised. Coral is now 96 and Joy 98.
I just feel very privileged that I've been in the work that I've been in. If the war hadn't been on, I wouldn't have been where I am now.
It doesn't sound much, but it was a lot. And I can tell you, I'm proud of it. very proud of it.
Beautiful.
Wow.
They're still great mates now.
Yeah, yeah.
Imagine signing something to say, like, you'd think, sure, I'll keep it secret what I'm doing now, not knowing for decades you'd have to pretend you just worked in signals, and whatever would be.
What the danger of it coming out after 50 years would have been.
No, 60's a lot.
Yeah, but so Ali Sinclair, who wrote the book about this, made a really interesting point that, like, imagine, like, they're 19 and they've never worked with technology before and suddenly they're having to deal with this stuff and they can't get it wrong.
No,
it's incredibly complicated what they're dealing with.
It's also, you imagine with these top secret, anything that you associate with the word spy, I instantly think of James Bond, tuxedos, martinis. Yeah. They're in a garage.
I know.
Yeah. Yeah. Like,
well, you wouldn't suspect them, would you?
No, you wouldn't. It's amazing.
I'll get away with it. Ali Sinclair's new book, The Codebreakers, is based on the experiences of Australia's garage girls. So if you're interested...